So, yes, the last purge, Senator Charlie Rowan, President Rowan, abolished the purge as the movie ends, right? So great, you know, that was my always intention that would be the end of the trilogy, but we continued. And so it was a challenge to say, well, how do we get to a place where the purge has been reinstated? So we kind of took as any, there's a new regime that's taken, has been voted into power that has very different policies on the purge than Senator Charlie's regime. So that was kind of, we layered that into the first 10 minutes of the film, I think in a kind of narrative style that there's a new regime change. The new founding fathers have been voted back in, kind of the bad guys have been voted back into the presidency, and they've reinstated the purge immediately.
So you've written every purge movie. What excited you most about this next chapter?
Yes, I've written every purge. I directed the first three, wrote four, and then wrote five. I think what excited me about this one, initially what excited me about this one, and this has since changed, but that it was going to be the final purge. So my answer is kind of doesn't really hold because now that's no longer true. But that was the initial thought. It was kind of the end of America, how the virus of the purge was going to end the country. We were saying that, but maybe there was hope there was going to be a revolution, but that was really the kind of the initial thought was that America would just be burning at the end of it, very nihilistic ending. But then we changed it. We said there's people fighting back and maybe there's hope in America. And then I woke up 3 months ago and came up with an idea for Purge 6. So that's changed since.
I was going to say, I thought this might be the last one because the last one is supposed to be the last one. So now you're saying that there's going to be another purge.
If all goes well, I guess, with the box office and people want it, we have another one. Yes, I'm actually outlining it right now. I have my cards, my outline cards. So yeah, so I came up with an idea about 3 months ago to turn everything upside down to extend the franchise and do something completely new with it, I think. So that's exciting. I hope.
That is very exciting. I think really exciting for a lot of the fans of the purge. Okay, so let's talk specifically about this one before we go on to the next one.
Yeah, before six. Exactly.
You created like all of these new settings. There are new rules in that there are no rules. Right. It's a new take on the story and it's all during daylight. Can you elaborate on that a little bit? Are scares more scary during daylight and things like that?
Yeah, no, exactly. So this one is completely new. The first thing we said we wanted to do in coming up with this part five was, well, how do we make it look different? The visual of the look of the film had to be different than the previous films. The previous films were all, you know, urban landscapes, nighttime, The Purge is 7 to 7. So we have to break that. This has to be a whole new visual palette that we could really show the audience that we've done something different, because that's my thing. I don't want to ever repeat ourselves. Even the idea of just re-entering another purge, we were like, well, they've seen that now. They've seen four movies with four 12-hour purges, and it's a night of lawlessness. Well, how do you one-up a night of lawlessness? Well, then there's one law to the purge, which is the purge ends. So the conceit suddenly was like, wow, well, there it is. Well, maybe it doesn't end. Maybe people, since they're starting to get used to not obeying laws, well, maybe they stop obeying the purge law, which is when the sirens ring at 7 o'clock in the morning, we stop purging. So the conceit was like, that really is what hit me as like the cowbell, like, okay, that's the movie. We can turn the idea of no rules into really there are no rules. Even there are no purge rules. And people just continue and they continue. And we thought that was a nice way to take five.
Yeah, it gave you like a lot of intricate scares. And I feel like a lot of viewers really go to see The Purge for like these new ways, new horror, yes, new scares and all that. So yes. Can you kind of talk about that a little bit, what we can expect this next round?
Yeah, I think what we expect here is that, like we said, we're breaking all the rules, that people aren't listening to any of the purge laws and they've now been planning this purge. They know it's going to continue. They know that they can do anything. So no law is holding them back. You got all the purge rules of you can only use certain class weapons. You can only purge until 7 in the morning. Since all that's out the window, we now see more elaborate forms of purging. We see bigger groups purging. We see different kind of traps that people now had time to set up and are taking place during the day. So I think, again, there's something about daylight purging that I found terrifying, and the way Everardo shot it, it's so bright that now seeing people in bloody bunny suits in weird traps suddenly becomes much scarier than in a dark alley at night, because now people really don't care anymore. They've really just let everything go. So I think that's kind of fun.
And the barren landscape, it's almost like a Western in itself.
Yes, you know? That was the idea. Sorry to interrupt. Yeah, the idea was the barren, you know, creating this barren landscape using desert regions, going into New Mexico. It created what we started to realize was this kind of noir Western, this modern day Western or Mexican Western towards the end. And again, that was really planned to make sure it looked different than the previous purges, so the audiences didn't think we were repeating ourselves.
And not only are you the writer, the creator, you're the shepherd of the whole entire franchise. What has impressed you the most in terms of the evolution of this story?
So what's impressed me the most about the evolution of the story is how we're now able to bring in different directors to take my initial vision and to put it through their perspective. So we had the African-American experience in Purge 4. Now we brought in Everardo for the Mexican-American experience. So I lay the foundation for these things, but it's really great to hand it off to someone who could then bring an air of authenticity, bring a voice that's very true, especially in modern society now. It's great to hear from new directors. And that's been a real privilege to see what especially Gerard and Everardo have brought to the piece, brought to the franchise. An air of authenticity I simply couldn't bring. Yes, I could lay the foundation for characters and story. They bring something that is just so unique that an Italian-American kid from New York couldn't bring to these pieces.
And I just have to ask this last question. I mean, the cast that you assembled is phenomenal. Can you talk a little bit about them?
Yeah, just listen, so the cast of Part 5 is, I think, I don't want to say it's the best because I don't want to be rude to the previous, but it's a great cast. All the casts have been great, but Part 5 really came together really well. Everardo brought in Anna and Tanoche. They were his first choice. He never deviated, and he didn't have to convince anyone. I knew Anna's work. He introduced me to Tanoche's work. And then the other ideas just came about. We heard Josh Lucas was interested. We couldn't have been more excited. I think I will take credit for Will Patton. I've loved Will Patton's work since No Way Out. And we tried to get Will into Part 3, actually. Will and I spoke on the phone. So bringing Will into Part 5 was just a joy. And it's just across the board. Everybody just fit perfectly. It's just a wonderful cast.